I must say I learned a lot from the Business Leaders Initiative on human rights, because it was quite pioneering, especially at the beginning. It was based on the Business Leaders Initiative on climate change, but that was much easier because companies could measure an improvement in their emissions, an improvement in their carbon footprint, if you like. But human rights was more pioneering for the companies like ABB and Novartis and Barclays Bank that started the work. And we got another kind of leadership when some United States companies, United States-based companies joined, like The Gap and Hewlett-Packard, and later GE and Coca-Cola, because they were big players. And in their different sectors, they were looking at issues of the supply chain in particular, looking at issues of working in countries of conflict. And I think it was very good to see that they were willing to invest time. When the initial 3 years of the Business Leaders Initiative on Human Rights was up, I thought that the companies, we had about 14 companies at that time, that they would wind up and say that was enough. But instead, they wanted to continue for another 3 years because they had found that it was good for their business to be thinking in terms of corporate responsibility being part of corporate sustainability. And they were learning about the work that was being done by John Ruggie under his mandate as the special representative of the Secretary General on Business and Human Rights. I also serve on, I chair the Human Rights Working Group of the Global Compact, and that's a very different arena. It's a much larger arena, and I think for the biggest companies, the Global Compact is a very low bar. They don't really have to do much. But where the real learning comes is in the networks. And there are now over 70 networks of the Global Compact. And I do see a willingness of some of the companies, like ABB notably, to pass on some of the lessons they've learned from the Business Leaders Initiative to small and medium-sized businesses in different parts of the world who are involved in these networks. And I've been at a number of the annual networks meetings. The most recent one was in Istanbul. And they are quite an interesting learning opportunity for businesses and NGOs and unions in countries that don't have a long tradition of corporate responsibility. So I think there has been some change. Obviously, I think it's easier for companies to measure their climate footprint. What I haven't yet seen is corporations take a leadership on the climate justice issues and begin to be interested in a transfer of technology, not to emerging markets in middle-income developing countries, but in the very poorest countries, because of the enormous effect it can have, an effect equivalent to the leapfrogging of the mobile phone, the way the mobile phone has enabled poor people, poor farmers, women, street vendors even. They all have mobile phones and they use them for tracking the markets, prices, they use them to transfer money, for education, for health, surveillance, etc. And this is only the beginning. And I think I'd love to see the private sector really take an initiative on climate justice, the market of the billions. Let me give you a health analogy. I chair the Gavi Alliance Board. And when the Gates Foundation put in money about 10 years ago and linked with the UN as a whole, the UNICEF, the World Health Organization, the World Bank, donor governments, developing countries, the private sector, the churches, in reaching the poorest children, what we did is we created a market for immunizing the poorest children. And the vaccine companies were interested, the pharmaceutical sector became interested. We need to create a market for the good, appropriate technologies for the poorest, who are the billions, and it will become sustainable.